So here we are in another one of our continuing series of videos that attempt to sort of frame out and introduce the chapters and our text, our griefs, journalism, a very short introduction. Chapter 6, Hacks versus Flax, raises some interesting questions about who sort of is in charge in journalism. Is it the journalists working in the public interest? Is it journalists working for employers? Is it employers themselves? Is it the Flax, the PR practitioners who outnumber, indeed outgun, journalists, given that these Flax are better paid and have more resources at their disposal than journalists. Public relations is even a newer, if you want to call it, profession than journalism. While there were certainly promoters and so on in the 19th century, it's really a 20th century phenomenon, and got maybe its biggest boost in World War I when the Creel Committee was more or less assigned the mission of promoting American involvement in the war. And George Creel, who was head of this committee, in charge of public relations and propaganda, ended up recruiting a good number of journalists, well-known and much-respected journalists, who bought into the patriotic gore, if you will, of that time, and to do the public relations work on behalf of the government, to kind of prove the power of public relations in shaping, or to use Edward Bernays' term, engineering public opinion. Bernays, of course, is the with Ivy Lee, or is considered one of the founders of modern public relations. So the question really is, do journalists operate independently of PR sources, or have they become, due to laziness or inexperience or overwork, overly dependent on public relations sources? And Hargreaves explores that question in the chapter. And he kind of concludes that any independent journalist activity may be the exception rather than the rules. And he argues that today there may be more what he calls churnalism going on, sort of news and information that's stirred up or kind of incited or instigated artificially by public relations professionals and people of that stripe, than there is journalism, more churnalism than journalism. And that this gap now that exists between perception and reality, between, if you want, truth and truthiness, which is, you know, the desire to believe whatever you want to believe, and act as if just because you want to believe it, it's so, has grown so large that there's a feeling that there is maybe no fixed facts, and that what we're dealing with all the time are claims and strategies. If you listen closely, and I encourage you to do this, if you listen closely to CNN, MSNBC, even Fox News, what you'll often hear is the term narrative. And you'll hear the reporters, the pundits, the news anchors you know, all the kind of talking heads that are on, and unfortunately I'm not referring to the kind of post-punk musical group, but you'll hear the kind of talking heads using the word narrative over and over again. Who, what, you know, trying to reshape the narrative, who has control of the narrative has shifted. And really what they're talking about is not truth or facts. What they're talking about, whose claims, whose public relations strategies seems to have the upper hand. And this operates not necessarily, inevitably it doesn't operate in the public interest. Instead of punching through the narrative that is falsely constructed for some agenda that the public doesn't share, journalists tend to just sort of measure the effectiveness of the prevailing narrative and how possible challenging that narrative with other narratives, not necessarily any truer, are. So that's it. And he also mentions, this is worth adding, that social media has, just as PR has sort of unsettled journalism, social media has unsettled PR, posing new and great challenges to their ability, well, let's use that word, to control the narrative.